So, looking closer to this section 3, verse 17 to 35, we are in the first part, 17 to 25. It is better if one performs his duty without fruitful desires or attachment. Krishna says, the examples of King Janaka, who is the father of Mother Sita, and Krishna himself, they perform the work to set example for others. So one should act in this way to set the correct example for people in general. So we are in that section. So last time we read 17 up to 19. In verse 17, Lord Krishna says, hopefully this slideshow will start. Okay. Lord Krishna says, but for one who takes pleasure in the self, whose human life is one of self-realization, and who is satiated, satisfied in the self only, fully satiated, for him there is no duty. Okay. So there is no Varnashrama duty. That's what we discuss. So like, now because of the material conditioning, we have certain propensity to work in certain way. We have certain psychophysical nature. So there is a prescription and prohibition for us to gradually advance in self-realization and gradually go upwards in different ladder of yoga, ultimately to the topmost rung, bhakti yoga. But for one who is already perfected, there is no rules and regulation, but they still act. But here he says there is no prescribed duty. That's what we read, right? But for one who takes pleasure in the self, whose human life is one of self-realization, and who is satisfied in the self only, fully situated, for him there is no duty. And in verse 18 he says, a self-realized man has no purpose to fulfill in the discharge of his prescribed duties. So while he is doing his prescribed duty, there is no purpose. Like he's not looking after the fruits. Okay, I go to work so that I can earn money, so that I can buy so and so, run my family, those things. So he has no purpose to fulfill discharge. He's not working to earn bread and butter. Nor has he any reason not to perform such work. So he has full freedom, but he doesn't have any reason to not perform such work. He performs to set example. Nor has he any need to depend on any other living beings. So he's completely renounced. So not depending on others for his livelihood. He depends only on Krishna. That means whatever by Krishna's arrangement, whatever comes to him, he accepts. But this is not the prescription for Arjuna. Krishna says, you are having certain psychophysical nature. You are a Kshatriya, right? So you have to work now. You are not a sannyasi at this point. So by hearing this, that for self-realized person, there is no duty. So Arjuna thinks, that's what I was saying before, that if one is conscious of Krishna, then there is no duty to perform. And if one is totally detached from fruits of the work one is doing, then Arjuna is saying, why should I fight? Why should one work? So particularly, you know, he's thinking, now why should I fight? So therefore Krishna answers whatever the doubt Arjuna may have in his heart. Krishna answers that in verses 19 to 30. He says, you have to act out of duty to set an example for others, because whatever great men do, common men follow. And he gives example of Janak Maharaj and himself, Krishna himself. And finally he says, you know, Arjuna, you are to do your duty because you are not yet there. So I think I can just go over all of this, and then we will read those verses in the Gita website. Okay, so verse 19 and 20. Then Lord Krishna says, therefore, without being attached to the fruits of activities, one should act as a matter of duty. For by working without attachment, one attains the Supreme. So this is the Nishkama Karma Yoga. By doing that, one attains the Supreme, he is saying, without attached to the fruits, but act as a matter of duty. And now he gives example in verse 20. Kings such as Janaka attain perfection solely by performance of prescribed duties. Therefore, just for the sake of educating the people in general, you should perform your work. So as we know, Janaka is father of Mother Sita. We learned from Ramayana. And he was one of the 12 authorities for us. The Vedic knowledge comes to us through the disciplic succession. And one of those authorities, they are called 12 Mahajans. They set example by their own conduct. So like there are Bhishma Pitamaha, there are others like Bali Maharaj, Janaka, Prahlada, so and so forth. There are 12, like Narad Muni, there are 12 authorities. So Janaka is one of those 12 authorities. We can follow their examples. So Srila Prabhupada is our founding Acharya, and he has set a perfect example for us as a perfect leader. This verse is about the leadership, and Srila Prabhupada started this Krishna consciousness movement simply by chanting Hare Krishna mantra. He says, I started this movement simply by chanting Hare Krishna mantra. I chanted in New York in a place called Tompkins Square Park, and soon people began to come to me. In this way, the Krishna consciousness movement gradually developed. So you can see this tree. This tree is still there in New York City. 5 years ago, I visited there, and they have a plaque below there. There is a chair, and this tree is a memorial tree of Srila Prabhupada. So the city has preserved this tree in that park. So Srila Prabhupada was fully renounced. He was sannyasi. He was retired in Vrindavan, and he has no worldly duties. For him, whatever comes by own accord, like whoever donated, the sannyasi has to just accept whatever the donation comes and survive on that. But he wanted to do greater welfare for the entire world. His heart was very much in pain by looking people suffering around the world. So he wanted to make solution. So he carried message of Lord Chaitanya in his heart. And he brought Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, and of course Lord Chaitanya's message. And just because of his sincere desire to do welfare of the human society and all the world, this movement started just from that small scale. You can see a small gathering there. So he was perfectly acting for Krishna's pleasure. That's what Krishna wants. Krishna says that towards the end of this Bhagavad Gita, there is no one better, there is no one more dear to me than the one who is, you know, one who is teaching my instruction to others. So Srila Prabhupada, as we discussed, I think, last time when he visited to US by a steamship. It was a cargo ship. It took him about a month to travel through Atlantic Ocean. And in his passport, he wrote his profession as teacher. So Srila Prabhupada was doing his activities of Krishna consciousness, propagation of Krishna consciousness, spreading glory of Krishna all over the world without attachment to results, fully detached. He had a return ticket in that boat. So he could return anytime, but then he just kept on chanting and glorifying Krishna, teaching Bhagavad Gita, and gradually students joined, and now we can see we have worldwide movement of Bhakti Yoga. So he was doing it as a duty to his spiritual master. When he was a young man, he met his spiritual master. I think he was about 24 years old. And at that time, spiritual master, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaj, he saw Srila Prabhupada. His name was Abhay Charan Day. And he says, "Abhay, you are a gentleman educated in English. Why not you preach the glory of Lord Chaitanya all over the world, particularly in Western countries, in English?" So Srila Prabhupada took his guru's instruction and he acted out of duty. And he was definitely guided by his guru. And he was fully confident. He prepared for many years. He was about 24 years old, first time when he met his spiritual master. And in next 10 years, he was working as a pharmacist in Allahabad. And there he got his spiritual initiation. And his name became Abhay Charan Arvinda Das. And from there on, he used to write letters to big leaders in India, like prime ministers, chief ministers, governors. And he even wrote to Mahatma Gandhi. And he says, "Gandhiji, why not teach the message of Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita? I know that you also like Bhagavad Gita. Why not establish a mission to propagate the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita all over the world?" So we have perfect example, Srila Prabhupada, as a leader for our society. So Lord Krishna says, "Whatever action a great man performs, common men follow. And whatever standard he set by exemplary act, all the world pursues." So Srila Prabhupada has set a very good example for us, that we should also feel grateful to Srila Prabhupada's painful journey and his tolerance and his compassion, that he tolerated all kind of inconveniences. Traveling in that age, like when you are 70 years old, is not easy. It's not easy to travel even by flight. What to say of traveling for a month, getting seasick and getting double heart attack on the way. He took a lot of austerity. After coming US, he used to be in line. There was one toilet and his followers were also living in his ashram. He had to wait for a dozen of other students to go to toilet in line. So yes, he tolerated all difficulties. just to give Krishna consciousness to the whole world. He was sannyasi, renounced. He was perfectly peaceful in Vrindavan. He had nothing to gain materially, but he was looking for the welfare and definitely Krishna's pleasure by doing everyone's welfare in the world. So Srila Prabhupada is perfect example, and in the purport we will read, Srila Prabhupada writes that there are natural leaders in society, like teachers, parents, and natural leaders. So we have to have responsibility as a teacher or as a parent. They have all responsibility to their dependents. The scripture says that one should not become a parent, or one should not become a teacher, one should not become a king unless one can deliver one's dependent. So that's the instruction in the scripture. Krishna gives his own example in the next verse 22. O Sana Pritha, there is no work prescribed for me within all the three planetary systems. So now, as we discussed, I think in the previous discussions, three planetary systems, which is the middle level where we are now, and the upper level is the heavenly planets, and then lower level, the lower standard of life. So in all three material world, there is no prescribed duty for Krishna. Nor am I in want of anything, nor have I a need to obtain anything, and yet I am engaged in prescribed duties. So Krishna need not to go and participate in that battlefield, but still he was engaged in prescribed duties to set example for others. So I think I said this already. And he says, for if I ever fail to engage in carefully performing prescribed duties, then O Partha, certainly all men would follow my path. And Srila Prabhupada will tell us very nice thing about this purport, very nice purport that we'll read today. And 24, if I did not perform prescribed duties, all these worlds would be put into ruination. I would be the cause of creating unwanted population, and I would thereby destroy the peace of all living beings. Do you remember in chapter 1, Arjuna was arguing that, oh, if I fight there and I kill some soldiers, then there will be loss of the leadership in the society. So the dependents of these people who die here, they will be fatherless, and there will be unwanted progenies in the societies and degradation of the society, because the forefathers are not there, and those who are departed, they will also not get their oblation or Vishnu Prasada. So the departed soul also cannot be liberated, because the dependents will not offer those rituals for their ancestors, those who are departed. So, as the ignorant perform their duties with attachment to results, the learned may similarly act, but without attachment. So we are in this section where Krishna is telling to work without attachment, for the sake of leading people on the right path. So I think I will stop here and stop sharing that one. And we'll read from those verses. So we are in chapter 3, Karma Yoga. Start reading from 19. Okay, verse 19. Tasmad asakta satatam कार्यं कर्म समाचर असक्तो हि आचरन् कर्म परमाप्नोति पुरुषः. ओके, वी नीड वॉलंटियर नंबर वन. लोकेंद्र प्रभु, कैन यू रीड? आर यू एबल टू सी अवर स्क्रीन?
यस प्रभु. हरे कृष्ण. आई विल रीड इट.
रीड प्रभु प्लीज इफ यू कैन.
देयरफॉर विदाउट बीइंग अटैच्ड टू द फ्रूट्स ऑफ एक्टिविटीज one should act as a matter of duty, for by working without attachment one attains the supreme purport. The supreme is the personality of Godhead for the devotees and liberation for impersonalists. A person therefore acting for Krishna or in Krishna consciousness under proper guidance and without attachment to the result of the work is certainly making progress toward the supreme goal of life. Arjuna is told that he should fight in the battle of Kurukshetra for the interest of Krishna because Krishna wanted him to fight. To be a good man or a non-violent man is a personal attachment, but to act on behalf of the supreme is to act without attachment for the result. That is perfect action of the highest degree, recommended by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Shri Krishna. Vedic rituals like prescribed sacrifices are performed for purification of impious activities that were performed in the field of sense gratification. But action in Krishna consciousness is transcendental to the reactions of good or evil work. A Krishna conscious person has no attachment for the result, but acts on behalf of Krishna alone. He engages in all kinds of activities, but is completely non-attached.
Thank you. So we are in the section where Krishna is telling that in the beginning, Lord sent men and demigods and yajnas and then told them to be happy by this performance of yajna. The demigods will be satisfied and then they will provide your resources to you. And by those resources, like the, for example, the rain will bring grain and all the resources that you will get, you will be happy and live peacefully. So there was a cycle of the yajna that we learned, that grain comes from rain comes from performance of yajna. And yajna is prescribed in the Vedas, and the Vedas come from breathing out of the Lord. So ultimately, for our food, for everything, we depend on God. So we should perform sacrifices. Srila Prabhupada says in this verse that, yes, rituals like yajnas are there for purification. Those who are interested to enjoy their senses, they are advised in the scriptures to enjoy under the rules and regulations of the scriptures. So perform karmakandas. Then gradually move ahead to karma yoga. And then gradually get detached and do the niskam karma yoga and gradually come to the bhakti yoga. And Srila Prabhupada says, action in Krishna consciousness is transcendental to the reaction of good or evil work. So when we directly take to Krishna consciousness, that means this is the elevator method. So instead of going step by step, elevating, if one takes to Krishna consciousness by the process of chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and regularly offering one's food as a sacrifice, and Maha Mantra is like Sankirtan Yajna, if we do that at least minimum these two, then we are directly in Krishna consciousness. We get rid of all kind of impurities, and the process itself is purification, because we learn that ahar shuddha, so our food is purified, our consciousness is purified, our body is purified by you know, following rules and regulations of like taking bath a certain time and all, chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra is purifying our consciousness. Prasadam is purifying our fine tissues. So the process of Krishna consciousness is perfectly yajna. Okay, so I think this is the new verse from today. Karmane vahi samsiddhim asthita janakadaya lokasangraham evapi sampasyan kartumarhasi. Okay, so who is the next volunteer? Prachi, are you there?
Translation. King such as Janaka attained perfection solely by performance of prescribed duties. Therefore, just for the sake of educating the people in general, you should perform your work. Purport. King like Janaka were all self-realized souls. Constantly, they had no obligation to perform the prescribed duty in the Vedas. Nonetheless, they performed all prescribed activities just to set example for the people in general. Janaka was the father of Sita and father-in-law of Lord Sri Rama. Being a great devotee to the Lord, he was transcendentally situated. But because he was the king of Mithila, a subdivision of Bihar province in India, he had to teach his subjects how to perform prescribed duties. Lord Krishna and Arjuna, the Lord's eternal friend, had no need to fight in the battle of Kurukshetra, but they fought to teach people in general that violence is also necessary in a situation where good argument fail. Before the battle of Kurukshetra, every effort was made to avoid the war, even by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But the other party was determined to fight. For such a right cause, there is necessity for fighting. Although one who is situated in Krishna consciousness may not have any interest in the world, he still works to teach the public how to live and how to act. Experienced person in Krishna consciousness can act in such a way that others will follow. And this is explained in the following verse.
Okay, any question on this? Or discussion? So I think everybody knows that Lord Krishna did not whimsically tell, hey, you guys go and fight. Those who were with me since the beginning, or in this group in the beginning, that we have discussed that Lord Krishna made every effort to avoid the war. He approached the Kauravas that these your cousins, Pandavas, they are Kshatriyas, right? So their psychophysical nature is to rule, their leadership. They need at least 5 villages to rule. That is their occupation. So the other party, Duryodhan, he says, no, I cannot give anything to them, not even a land to drive a pin. So Krishna then says, yes, they are so adamant, there is no other option. We have exhausted all the negotiation, all the peaceful efforts. So finally, you guys have a dharma, and to establish the dharma you have to fight. So although Krishna is Supreme Personality of Godhead, Arjuna is a devotee, eternal friend means Arjuna is not a conditioned soul like us, but he is asking questions for our benefit. Arjuna is fully liberated, he is always a friend. Wherever Krishna goes, Arjuna is there with him. Krishna and Krishna's Leela, Krishna's activities are called Nitya Leela. Like Krishna was on this earth planet, then after he leaves this planet, he goes to another planet and Arjuna follows him. Then after that planet, they go to the next planet. So like Right now, there may be Kurukshetra wars in some planet. Right now, there will be, Krishna is stealing butter in some planet. So Krishna's activities, they are eternal. Krishna Janmashtami is celebrated somewhere right now. So Krishna's birth activities, all those activities, Krishna's activities are eternal. So Arjuna is eternal friend. Wherever Krishna goes, Arjuna follows. And he was not in illusion. He was a liberated soul. That means, what is a liberated soul means? One who understands one's perfect relationship with Krishna. It's called liberated soul. But right now, in this Bhagavad Gita station, Arjuna's consciousness is covered by the higher arrangement called Yoga Maya, the spiritual potency of Krishna, spiritual energy of Krishna, just so that Arjuna could ask questions for people in general, those who are conditioned in the material world. So, just to teach the example that yes, violence is necessary if the peaceful efforts fail. Krishna is telling Arjuna to fight. Verse 21. This is very, very, very famous verse. And it goes like this. Yad yad acharati shreshthas tat tat evetaro jana sayat pramanam kurute lokas tat anuvartate. Okay. So next volunteer. We have Swami Mataji. Swamitra Mataji.
Yes. Yes, Ji. Hare Krishna. People in general always require a leader who can teach the public by practical behavior. A leader can teach the public to stop smoking if he himself smokes. Lord Chaitanya said that a teacher should behave properly before he begins teaching. One who teaches in the way is called Acharya or the ideal teacher. Therefore, a teacher must follow the principles of Shastra, scripture, to teach the common man. The teacher cannot manufacture rules against the principles of revealed scriptures. The revealed scriptures like Manu Samhita and similar others are considered the standard books to be followed by human society. Thus, the leader teaching should be based on the principle of such standard shastras. One who desires to improve himself must follow the standard rules as they are practiced by the great teachers. The Srimad Bhagavatam also affirms that one should follow in the footsteps of great devotees, and that is the way of progress on the path of spiritual realization. The king of the executive head of the state, the father, and the school teacher are all considered to be natural leaders of the innocent people in general. All such natural leaders have to be great responsibility to their dependents. Therefore, they must be conversant with standard books of morals and spiritual codes.
So thank you, Mataji. So you have a great responsibility.
Yes, SG.
Yes, we all have great responsibility as parents. We are natural leaders. So we should be conversant of the moral and spiritual codes. Definitely we have to learn from the scriptures for us. The guiding scripture is Bhagavad Gita, learning from Bhagavad Gita, Srila Prabhupada's purport. And if we want further details, we can read from Srimad Bhagavatam, which is basically the expanded version of the instruction we are getting in Bhagavad Gita. So this is a Gita Upanishad, it's called Fifth Vedas in Bhagavad Gita, and Srimad Bhagavatam is Bhagavad Puran, so which gives case studies how different personalities followed instruction of God, Krishna, and how some people disregarded and what happened to them. So that's the expanded version of the Bhagavad Gita. So after we finish Bhagavad Gita, and when we accept Krishna as our spiritual master in our life, we accept Krishna as authority for our life, then we can get further details from Srimad Bhagavatam. Thank you. So verse 22, Lord Krishna will tell about himself. Na me partha asti kartavyam trishu loke sukinchana nanavaptam avaptavyam varta eva cha karmani. Now I see Lalina Mataji.
Hey Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Please read the translation for Prabhu.
O son of Partha, there's no work prescribed for me within all the three planetary systems. Nor am I in want of anything, nor have I a need to obtain anything. And yet I am engaged in prescribed duties. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is described in Vedic literature as follows. The Supreme Lord is the controller of all other controllers, and he is the greatest of all the diverse planetary leaders. Everyone is under his control. All entities are delegated with particular power only by Supreme Lord. They are not supreme themselves. He is also worshipable by all demigods and is the supreme director of all directors. Therefore, he is transcendental to all kind of material leader and controller and is worshipable by all. There is no one greater than him, and he is the supreme cause of all causes. He does not possess a bodily form like that of ordinary living entity. There's no difference between his body and his soul. He is absolute. All his senses are transcendental. Any one of his senses can perform the action of any other sense. Therefore, no one is greater than him or equal to him. His potencies are multifarious, and thus his deeds are automatically performed as a natural sequence. Since everything is in full opulence in the personality of Godhead and is existing in full truth, there is no duty for the Supreme Personality of Godhead to perform. One who must receive the result of work has some designated duty, but one who has nothing to achieve within the three planetary systems certainly has no duty. And yet Lord Krishna is engaged on the battlefield of Kurukshetra as the leader of Kshatriya, because the Kshatriyas are the duty bound to give protection to the distressed. Although he is above all the regulations of the revealed scriptures, he does not do anything that violates the revealed scripture.
Thank you, Mataji. So these two verses of Shvetashvatara Upanishad 6.7 and 8, they perfectly describe the characteristics of God. If we want to introduce somebody to what is God, the definition of God is described there. So God, Krishna is, you know, Bhagavan Uvacha. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, right? So he is described as a controller of all the controllers, greatest of all the leaders. Like there are the leading leaders of each planets. So he is the leader of them all. He is the supreme controller. All the demigods are controlled by him. This is what we have learned, right? So everybody is worshipping him. There is no one greater than him. Also, he is different than, although he may have a form, but his form is different than our form. he can do different activities from different limbs of his body. Like we discussed in verse 13 of this chapter, that Lord Krishna can eat by seeing the food. So when we offer food, when we chant the mantra for offering food, he can eat by his ear, by hearing the mantra that we are chanting. Also, he can eat by looking, seeing the food. The deity can see, deity can hear, so he can accept. So anyway, these are the characteristics of Krishna. And just by his willpower, everything happens. He does not have to work hard to hold something. He is holding the whole universe, but he should not. He's not like somebody who is burdened. Just by his willpower, everything happens. So he doesn't have anything to achieve. Everything is available to him, but he still does duty of a kshatriya, because the kshatriyas have to set example. Krishna is setting example. The kshatriya has to protect their citizens. So that's what they are doing, setting example here. Thank you. Okay, so what happens if he fails to engage his duty? Lord Krishna says in this verse 23, yadi hi aham na vartayam jatu karmani atandritah mama vartvano vartante manushya partha sarvashah. This is also one of the famous verses quoted by Srila Prabhupada. Okay, so who is next? Pravesh, are you there?
Yeah. Translation. For if I ever fail to engage in carefully performing prescribed duties, O Partha, certainly all men would follow my path. Proper. In order to keep the balance of social tranquility for progress in spiritual life, there are traditional family usages meant for every civilized man. Although such rules and regulations are for the conditioned souls and not for Krishna, because he descended to establish the principles of religion, he followed the prescribed rules. Otherwise, common men would follow in his footsteps because he is the greatest authority. From the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is understood that Lord Krishna was performing all the religious duties at home and out of home as required of a household.
Yes, again, Srila Prabhupada quotes Srimad Bhagavatam, because Srimad Bhagavatam gives all the activities of Lord Krishna. How he appeared in Vrindavan, in Mathura, how he went to Vrindavan, and what activity he did in childhood, in youth, and how he killed so many demons, and all the activities of Lord Krishna, all transcendental activities described there in Srimad Bhagavatam. So he was perfectly setting example of an ideal householder when he was a grihastha in Dwarka. So he's setting example for common men, because common men, they want to have role models in society. So when they are celebrities, they do something, the common men follow, right? So Krishna is a supreme celebrity. So he is setting example for us. He continues. 24. Ussideyur ime loka na kuryam karma chedaham Sankarasya cha kartasyam upahanyam imam praja. Okay, seems everybody read once. Aditya, did you read? Maybe you can try again. Yeah. Okay, seems you. Somebody else, Prachi, you may try this.
If I did not perform prescribed duties, all these worlds would be put to ruination. I would be cause of creating unwanted population, and I would thereby destroy the peace of all living beings. Purport. Varna Sankara is unwanted population which disturbs the peace of the general society. In order to check this social disturbance, there are prescribed rules and regulations by which the population can automatically become peaceful and organized for spiritual progress in life. When Lord Krishna descends, naturally he deals with such rules and regulations in order to maintain the prestige and necessity of such important performances. The Lord is the father of all living entities, and if the living entities are misguided, indirectly the responsibility goes to the Lord. Therefore, whenever there is general disregard of regulative principles, the Lord himself descends and corrects the society. We should, however, note carefully that although we have to follow in the footsteps of the Lord, we still have to remember that we cannot imitate him. Following and imitating are not on the same level. We cannot imitate the Lord by lifting Govardhan Hill, as the Lord did in his childhood. It is impossible for any human being. We have to follow his instruction, but we may not imitate him at any time. The Srimad Bhagavatam 10.33.30 and Srivam affirms Natat Samache Jatu Manasapi Hai Anvaraha Vinasat Acharan Maudhaya Yathradra Badhijam Visham Iswaranam Vacha Satyam Tat Hai Vacha Charitam Kavachit Tesam Yat Swa Vacho Yuktam Buddhimanam Tat Samachat Samacharit. One should simply follow the instruction of the Lord and his empowered servants. Their instructions are all good for us, and any intelligent person will perform them as instructed. However, one should guard against trying to imitate their actions. One should not try to drink the ocean of poison in imitate of Lord Shiva. We should always consider the position of the Ishwaras, or those who can actually control the movements of the sun and moon, as superior. Without such power, one cannot imitate the Ishwara, who are super powerful. Lord Shiva drank poison to the extent of swelling an ocean. But if any common man tries to drink even a fragment of such poison, he will be killed. There are many pseudo-devotees of Lord Shiva who want to indulge in smoking ganja, marijuana, and similarly intoxication drugs, forgetting that by so imitating the acts of Lord Shiva, they are calling death very near. Similarly, there are some pseudo-devotees of Lord Krishna who prefer to imitate the Lord in his Rasleela, a dance of love, forgetting their inability to lift Govardhan Hill. It is best, therefore, the one not to try to imitate the powerful, but simply follow their instructions. Nor should one try to occupy their post without qualification. There are so many incarnations of God without the power of the Supreme Godhead.
So, Prachi, you read this before with us in a different group. Remember?
The chapter 3, this verse.
This verse, yeah.
I don't remember.
Yeah, okay. There are so many incarnations of God without the power of the Supreme Godhead. So, so-called incarnations of God. So, imitative God. Like there are many, they start showing off themselves as like, I am incarnation of God. So, they show some magic and people think, oh, he is God, like that. So, for them, Srila Prabhupada says, can you live to Govardhan Hill? They say, okay, at least you lived. In our Hare Krishna temples, during Govardhan Puja, we make hills of halwa, right? hills made of halwas and puris and all the prasadams offered to Govardhan. So, you know, the devotee says, you know, you should at least lift the halwa hill. So they cannot even lift the halwa hill, but they prove themselves God. So anyway, Srila Prabhupada is saying that, you know, some people, like they say, oh, I am a devotee of Lord Shiva, and so I smoke ganja and, you know, intoxicants. They take all kinds of drugs and they say, yeah, Lord Shiva took these, and so we are followers, you know, but they are imitating. Similarly, some people, they try to imitate Lord Krishna. They say, we are devotee of Krishna. One student came to me and said, yeah, I like Krishna. And then I said, why do you like? Yeah, because he had many girlfriends. Yeah. Okay, you know, so like people just try to imitate. They don't know that everybody is Krishna's girlfriend. Everybody, all of us are Krishna's girlfriend. Everybody is Krishna's property. So Krishna is not dancing with somebody else. All the gopis, they wanted Krishna. So anyway, that's some of the confidential pastimes of Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada is giving us warning that we should not imitate, but we should follow Krishna's instructions. Krishna still follows most of the rules and regulations, but there are some places where he also displays his own nature. So, but then, you know, Srila Prabhupada says that one man's, what is that called? One man's food is poison for others, something like that. So Lord Shiva can drink the poison coming out from the charnika of the ocean. So when the poison came out, Lord Shiva accepted. And therefore he is called Nilakanta. So his neck become turned blue because of the poison he hold there. So we cannot simply imitate some of the things the great Lord Shiva and Lord Krishna did, but we should follow their instructions. That's why Srila Prabhupada gives the instruction to us. Okay, so I think we are 1 hour here, so we should continue from verse 25 onwards next Sunday. Any discussion so far? Any doubt or anything new which came across and you're surprised or you want certain clarification, so we can discuss. Today's the session was about leadership, the characteristics of leaders, how the leader should lead the society by example, not to disturb them, but let them understand what is their prescribed duty. Sannyasis have different duty, but they act to lead people in general for progressive Krishna consciousness. Okay. So everybody is good?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. So we are in what stage? Are we in that liberated stage? Or we are in non-liberated stage? So the thing is, like, Krishna is giving instruction to us that we have to do the duty according to our psychophysical nature. So right now, where we are, we have to do our duty according to the psychophysical nature, right, Mataji?
Karma Yoga.
Karma Yoga, yes, Mataji, yes. So we have to do karma yoga, connecting our activities for pleasure of Krishna. Thank you, Mataji. Karma yoga. Yes, we are in karma yoga chapter. Karma yoga. And gradually get detached. So we may be stuck on karma yoga. We may be looking for fruit now, but gradually we have to practice to offer the fruits to Krishna, to please Krishna. And gradually we, you know, move ahead from shakam karma to nishkama karma, karma yoga. Thank you, Mataji. We are in karma yoga chapter. We have to do karma yoga. Yeah. Very nice. Thank you so much. It seems everybody is happy today. And hope we can chant Hare Krishna regularly. That way we are connecting our activities, our karma to Krishna. That becomes karma yoga. Simply by chanting Krishna's name, we are with Krishna. And offering all the food to Krishna, Krishna is pleased. And we are pleased. Everybody in the world is pleased by offering their food, by offering their activities with love and devotion. Thank you so much for your love and devotion to Bhagavad Gita and joining today's discussion. Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.